what I said in my previous video was really something that I really, in fact, struggled desperately to be able to say in the past, and especially whilst doing my PhD, because the logic, the psychologic of a narcissistic society mitigates against perceiving the world in a perspective that doesn't automatically naturalize and take for granted dynamics as being narcissistic and not something else. And that's why I insist and continue to insist on a historical perspective, because history makes us aware of things that are not related to individuals, not related to their worldview, not related to their self-interest. History is anti-narcissistic. It's an explanation that furnishes us with knowledge and values and a means to come to terms with reality that is not based on the principle of my self-interest. One may still pursue, of course, one's self-interest, but one doesn't turn it into the whole. One doesn't make it into the whole field of knowledge with nothing more lying outside of that. In fact, a great deal and the majority of things that occur are outside of what one happens to know or even what one happens to desire. But the narcissistic worldview has it, or would have it, as the opposite, that there's nothing worth knowing unless it serves me, and there's nothing worth acknowledging unless it fits into my needs, my desires, my appetite for enjoyment or self-aggrandizement or what have you. But it's all about me. So history is important, and I keep introducing it. Like I say, once again, it has nothing to do with diminishing or denying the ego and its role. That also has to have a role. We also do need to pursue our interests. But it puts them in perspective, and that's the important thing. I've been working hard lately. Sorry, my hair is not great. I am working hard lately. Have to stay up very late and do a little bit of work whilst remaining up late, and it gets cold. Not very cold here, actually. It's the beginning of winter, and I think I'm already adjusting to it. Reading again the philosophy and the theorization of the French philosopher, or he might call himself simply a thinker, Georges Bataille. I always wish I could have a better French accent with that. He does make me realize how his philosophy, even though it seems very negative, is in fact medicine for the Western psyche. It is it's the medicine that basically destroys narcissism in the Western psyche. I was going to say in the Western society, I'm not so sure, but it attacks the narcissism that seems to aggregate in the psyche. And it brings us back to health. And it seems, actually doesn't seem to be doing that at all. It seems very negative. And when I encountered it, just like when I encountered Nietzsche, it was alien. Seemed kind of an exotic experiment worth trying, and in some way giving me a better hold on reality, even right at the beginning, and especially psychological reality. But I didn't like it. I just kind of imposed it on myself as a medicine because I thought, well, nothing can be worse than this very narrow, very rigid Christian mindset that I'm caught up in. Nothing. So anything, you know, possibly anything would be better than this. And it's already giving me a few positive results, even as I incorporate a very small amount of knowledge and start applying that as a principle. Already, I know more, I'm feeling better, I see things more clearly, perhaps as they are. And actually, Bataille has a similar thing. He seems very alien, very almost mystical, and he employs the language of mysticism, which makes it even more confusing, because he's not actually a mystic, not at all. He's using a totally different system, a very rational system, to bring us back to self-awareness and to health. And it can be very hard to see that because you're, and as humans, we're inclined to cling to things that we know or feel that we know, even if we don't know them. And that's the whole principle behind, of course, cognitive dissonance. We just resolve that we won't take in new information because we've got the old information, and the new information unsettles us, so we'll pretend it's not even there. And so it is actually difficult to let go of what you imagine or maintain that you know, and embrace the unknown and the not yet experienced. And that's how Bataille, I think, strikes us, or would strike us if we were trying to come to terms with him, which most of us obviously are not, and not being intellectuals and so on. His whole approach to anything is dialectical. He's looking at things in this manner. And dialectics, as I explained to you, means movement, means change, means understanding and accepting change. That's the real nature of dialectics. Of course, we break it down. We break down the nature of change into conceptualizations, and we say, well, there are actions, there are reactions, there is maybe two sides to the coin, and it tends to break down into a binary where we see things as divided into two, just so that we can conceptualize change. We can say, well, now this party negotiated with that party and they came to an agreement, and finally the new agreement was better than the past situation because they were no longer battling it out in a state of contradiction. Now they have something that makes better sense to everybody, not just one party or the other party. And so that's a better thing. That's called progress. So dialectics often encapsulates this notion of progress. But it doesn't have to be just regarding progress. It's much more broadly, it's the way things change. And they change in a way that is so quick all the time, this moment to the next moment to the next moment, that we don't see it as dialectical. But if we try to conceptualize it, then we end up breaking it down and we make it have to do with a to and a fro between different concepts in our mind, weighing this up, weighing that up, and understanding that this is a way forward on the basis of weighing the two sides up. It's another way to look at it, but that's breaking it down. That's slowing down the process. That's making it digestible to the part of our mind that conceptualizes and analyzes. So that analytical part of our mind is very slow. It's so slow, and it's why people that do martial arts and learn about it, learn not, you know, the whole Zen principle, don't analyze, just do. It's because of that, because once you analyze, you're slowing down the process. And almost bringing it to a stop and turning it into something that it really isn't. It has to be movement. It has to be change. By the time you start to think about it, it's not the same thing anymore. It becomes something rigidified in your mind. And we know who rigidifies things in their mind and makes things seem never to change. Who have a proclivity for things seeming to be like a statue and perfect in that mode of actually being unable to change. Narcissists. So we don't want to be falsifying reality by constantly stopping it off and choking it and saying, that's about as much as I can take from you. We want to allow it to continue. We want life to continue. We want it to flow on. Nietzsche and Bataille are all about life flowing on. And not being stopped and said, well, like, that's it. That's all we can know because that's all we can conceptualize. That's all we want to conceptualize. It's all we're prepared to take in about you or about that situation or about the meaning of life in general. We can't do it more than that because we've become narcissistic and rigidified or we are afraid. And that's more of the likely reason, too, in many aspects of the human pursuit of knowledge and academia. We're afraid of death. Who else is afraid of death? Who else doesn't want to die? Who else sees it as the ultimate degradation of their projected perfection? Narcissists. So We try to stop reality when we fear it. We try to cordon it off and limit it with concepts and make it seem very, very open to our penetration, our minds, and that way we feel that we have gained a sense of mastery over it. And when we gain that sense of mastery, we feel that we're warding off death. That's why, that's the psychology of generally why we try to attain mastery. But there are other reasons too, joy and pleasure. But in many instances, when we stop short of attaining a full mastery, because we stop because we are suddenly afraid of death and we don't want to go further in case we dissolve ourselves, in case we find something we don't want to find, in case we find something scary, harmful, or disturbing, or something that indeed upsets our whole paradigm and makes us rethink, because that's an exposure to our own limitations, our mortality, our failures, our confusion, which all come under the overarching umbrella of death. It's how we feel. It's how we psychologically react to things. So what Bataille is saying is, keep going, keep going, keep going. It seems like you're entering death. In fact, you are. You are entering death. You're on a trajectory as a mortal human being toward death. But keep going, keep going, keep going. Don't let it scare you. Don't let the disintegration scare you. Don't let the dread that you have and the acknowledgement of death scare you. Don't be narcissistic and try and cordon off the flow of life just to protect yourself when in fact you're blocking the way to knowledge. And knowledge has to be that flow, even if it is, and in fact it is, a flow toward death. But don't block it off because of your own fear, your own desire to remain immortal. Who wants to remain immortal? A narcissist. Well, we can't afford that. We can't afford that weakness, that vulnerability, that fragility of character that would just stop off knowledge to serve ourselves. We must keep going with it. And it's not going to be pleasant. But at the same time, it serves knowledge. Bataille had this debate, or I think it was very short-lived, a interaction with Jean-Paul Sartre. And Sartre was saying, well, you know, we just need to stay on this positive side of knowledge. I don't mean he thought it was a positive mood, but just positivistic. We need to state what we know, and we need to work toward a better society, work towards something better. And it isn't so much that Jean-Paul Sartre got it wrong. It's just that his perspective was relatively about this narrow, and Bataille's perspective was broad, and in fact pushing out into greater broadness and greater incorporation of understanding of the human condition. And so, in effect, it seems Sartre was unable to take into consideration what Bataille was actually doing. From Sartre's perspective, it seems that Bataille was just trying to destroy this really precious small accumulation of knowledge that Sartre had gained, and made his own mark, circled around, and demarcated as correct and true for human society. And it can certainly seem like that. It can seem that way. Because when you move outside of that sphere of what you think you know, it feels like death. It feels like disintegration. It feels terrible. It's better to, you know, some people think it's better to stay just with what you know and live that out to the end of your life and not know any more than what you already do or what you think you do. Because otherwise you introduce the other side of the dialectic, not just positive knowledge, knowledge that's gained as, you know, your own factual or semi-factual assertions, but the questioning and the doubt and the uncertainty that introduces the negative dialectic, but it expands ultimately. It expands your knowledge base if you can introduce doubt, introduce uncertainty, introduce, in effect, this very human symbolic notion of death. And that produces through, you know, pain and agony and expansion of your knowledge. But yes, as I say, it's dialectical, it's a process, it's a movement, and it guarantees no particular result except a certain expansion of knowledge, which may not be pleasant, may not bring happiness, but does expand you. And my understanding, too, is that it negates narcissism, because every time you cordon it off, you say, I'm the master, I've achieved perfection, I'm great just the way I am, I want to stop death, I want to be this eternal statue of who I am today. Well, it's narcissistic atrophication, maybe mildly, or maybe very severe. And the cure to narcissistic atrophication, facing death, acknowledging death, facing the movement toward death in anguish. And I'll post underneath this video the very, very difficult, don't underestimate it, very difficult indeed. You would have to have read Hegel, very complex, but very brief article where Bataille expresses his rebuttal to Sartre. Enjoy.